Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we're studying the Sabbath School lessons prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church for the second quarter, that's the months of April, May, and June of 2014. This particular series is entitled Christ and His Law, and this is number 12 in that series for June 21 of 2014, and it's entitled Christ's Church and the Law. And you might guess that this is talking about the early disciples, the early apostles, and how the church got started and how that was related to the law and the keeping of the law. We'll find out as we study our lesson together. I hope you have your Bible handy because we're going to look at a lot of Bible verses. We want to make sure you can check on us to make sure we're not misrepresenting anything here. So we'd like to begin with a word of prayer. Would you please bow your heads with us? Our wonderful Father, we come now before your presence to ask for your guidance on this special day. As we open your word, may we understand what you intended for us to know and for you, what you intended for us to learn is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The history of humanity's response to God's love and His law has been a very sad one. I don't think I need to tell anybody who's done much reading in the Bible or knows anything about church history about that fact. God started in the garden, just think about it now for a moment. God started in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, and they sinned. They ate of the tree. They were expelled from the garden. And it wasn't very long before He had to destroy the whole world with a flood and start over with Noah. And it wasn't very long before there they were at the Tower of Babel. And then it wasn't very long after that until He started over with Abraham and had to take Abraham away from his home to keep him from being seduced into idolatry. And then after having worked with Abraham and his family for a couple, 1,500 years, something like that, He finally says, well, you know, these people have to give up on them as well. So He goes to the Christian church and He says, let's work with the Christian church. And the apostles apparently did very well in the beginning, but 1,000 years later, we're in the depths of a dark age. And by another several hundred years, and suddenly there's a Protestant Reformation. You think, I'm sure the devil must have thought many times, I'm just that close to just completely eliminating God's people from planet Earth. Think about the times of Elijah when God says, well, Elijah said to God, I'm the only one left. And what did God say to him?
There's more.
Still 7,000 who haven't bowed the knee to Baal. Well, I don't know what God would say about us today. I hope it would be better than that. But remarkable as it may be, in the book of Revelation, it talks about a group of people at the end of time, at the very worst time in human history, that are apparently going to be very faithful to God and faithful in keeping His commandments. How is that going to be possible? So this lesson will focus on how God's law relates to each of these groups down through history and how law and grace together provide the key to our salvation. So let's start out back at the beginning. Why do you think God put that tree in the Garden of Eden? Wouldn't it have been better just to leave it out of there? Don't everybody talk at once.
God does everything out in the open. Uh-huh. And this earth was created to answer the questions that the two-thirds of the angels which stayed in heaven had. Mm-hmm. And so He couldn't just banish Lucifer, or excuse me, it was Satan by that time. So He had to, but He did confine him to that tree, so that, my understanding, that they couldn't be chasing Adam and Eve around the garden. And the rest obviously is history, but
so you're suggesting to us that the tree was there because evil was already in the universe.
Exactly.
The great controversy had already started. Satan had already sinned. He had already been cast down to this earth according to Revelation 12. And so here He is, and Satan says, here I am. If you're going to create this new world, I have to be a part of it. And He's been an overwhelming part of it, unfortunately.
We don't really grasp how God really is open about his government. His truth cannot be force-fed, and you can't force through duress or threats or intimidation intelligent creatures to do the right thing.
I thought that's what the church has been doing for hundreds of years.
Well, one facet of it, and then they look what they ended up riding the beast.
Well, he didn't create Adam and Eve as robots. They had a power of choice.
Yeah.
And that's a big part of what you just mentioned.
Well, if you understand that the two-thirds of the angels that heard, all of the angels, all the heavenly messenger, the stars of heaven, heard the lies. And a third of them bought it and ended up with Satan down here. But the other two-thirds heard the lies. They still had questions that needed to be answered, and it wasn't answered until Jesus' death on the cross. Mm-hmm. His death on the cross was to answer questions and demonstrate the truth about God rather than payment of a penalty.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, let's just run through that very quickly. In order to have freedom, you must have choice. In order to have choice and not just chance, you have to have at least a semi-orderly universe. So when you choose something, you know what you're getting, and tomorrow it's going to be the same thing as you chose today. And that orderly universe which God created makes it possible for people to do science. That if things were just chaotic, you couldn't do science. There would be no such thing as science. But then if all that is in place, then God has to allow us to have choice, and that choice means that we have to, if we're going to be able to love, we also have to be able to hate. We also have to be able to vote against God's love, and that's what happened.
And the choice being to live in harmony with the Creator, mm-hmm. or to attempt to go your own self-centered way. And that's what love is, and God is love. God is not a schizophrenic. He's not love part of the time. So we need to ultimately explain God's anger, God's wrath.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm reminded when you talk like that of a campaign speech one time that Abraham Lincoln was making, and someone in the audience, a lady, stood up and said, "Abe, you're just a two-faced president, or you want to be a two-faced president." And I think it was because he was supporting freedom for the slaves. And Abe's response was a very good one. I think he said, "Lady, if I were two-faced, do you think I'd be wearing this one?"
Good story.
Anyway, so here we have it. God has to allow freedom. He has to give Satan his chance. I believe that the tree of knowledge was put there as a protection, supposed to be a protection from Adam and Eve, because they were supposed to stay away from it, and Satan couldn't chase them wherever they went in the garden. So in light of all that, yeah.
You said God has to allow freedom.
In order to have love.
God is love. And so we have freedom because God is love. Yeah. And it's not something God says, "Just gonna, okay, I'll let you have it." No, it's the way he functions all the time.
And that's the way he runs his universe. Yeah.
But isn't the tree sort of a really hard temptation to deal with? Because let's say a child, you put something and say, "Don't touch that." Usually they don't want to touch it. No?
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Well, how are we supposed to live in our lives in light of all that? We're supposed to maybe make good, determined, carefully thought out moral choices, right? What's a moral choice?
Being able to see the alternate to that. And hopefully one is raised along those lines, and that's a problem we deal with today. They're not necessarily raised that way.
Moral choices happen when we see two possible paths, and we might be tempted to go either way, and yet we can see that this way is better than that way, and we go the right way because we believe that's the right thing to do.
But probably because we've had some education, we've had some learning process that going on. It's not something we're born with.
Yeah. Right. But you know, our minds are only capable of making a certain number of thought out decisions per day. Mm-hmm. If we had to think of everything we do in the morning, you wake up, okay, which sock goes on which foot and which shoe goes on which side and how do I put on my pants and so forth. If you had to think through each one of those things and we had no habit patterns, we'd be fatigued before we got to work. Yeah. You know? So we need to have habit patterns so we don't have to think through every detail things we do all day long.
You think Adam and Eve had a pattern?
I think they learned pretty quickly.
You think they learned pretty quickly?
Mm-hmm.
No, I guess that can't be answered, really.
No, you're right. I think that's one of the things we can ask when we get to heaven.
Yeah.
One surmise is that there might have been a greater length of time from creation to when they fell. Yeah. But
whatever there was, there was still no excuse for
it. No, but we don't know, do we?
No.
But you got to admit, though, they were pretty young.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you've got angels up there. Who knows how long they've been living, and they went through what Satan brought. And then these guys, God told them, don't touch the fruit. And Satan says, you can touch the fruit. You won't die. Okay.
He didn't say touch it. Don't eat it. Huh? There was nothing. Eve was the one that says, don't touch it.
Okay.
Eating was a big difference. There was no sin.
That's kind of a moot point. I'm trying to say that. You got these two people. One says to eat it, and the other one says don't eat it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So how are they going to make the decision?
This is a moral choice now.
And who did they
trust? It's a moral choice, but I guess my point is, are you sure they had enough experience and background to make that moral choice?
Okay, my comment would be, do you think God would leave them without enough information? No. Not to make the choice for them.
I don't even know why God would put that thing in the middle of their house anyway.
Well,
put that thing right there. Why would he even do that? So he did it.
Okay, when the human race, and let's look at, we got a lot of history to cover. Let's move on to the flood. And with that, we have to go to Genesis 6. I'm starting to read from verse 1. When the human race had spread all over the world, and daughters were being born, some of the heavenly beings saw that these young women are beautiful, so they took the ones they liked. Now, unfortunately, this is one of a few places in the Bible where I'm not happy with my translation. It says, when the sons of God saw the daughters of men, they took them. What are the sons of men and the daughters of God? What does that mean?
Well, it's two different teams, so to speak.
Ellen White makes it very clear that when Moses wrote those words, he meant the sons of God were referring to the faithful children of Seth, and the daughters of men were talking about the daughters of the descendants of Cain. So, you know what happened anyway. Then the Lord said, I will not allow people to live forever. They are mortal. From now on, they will live no longer than 120 years. In those days, and even later, there were giants on the earth who were descendants of human women and the heavenly beings. And it would be fun to talk about that, but we don't have time. They were the great heroes and famous men of long ago. When the Lord saw how wicked everyone on earth was and how evil their thoughts were all the time, he was sorry he had ever made them and put them on the earth. There's something we need to deal with. He was so filled with regret that he said, I will wipe out these people I have created and also the animals and the birds because I am sorry that I made any of them. But the Lord was pleased with Noah. Is the Lord really sorry for what he did?
Is that kind of the same word for repentant?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So did God
It's not really the same as repent. He's sorry.
He's sorry. Well, I mean, what? I think it's kind of the same thing, isn't it? Aren't you sorry that you, when you repent, that you pull back from it, that you're sorry that you even had that idea in the first place?
I'd like to take you to some other verses in the Bible that are similar, or throw some real challenges at us. Look at 1 Samuel 15, verse 29. Israel's majestic God does not lie or change his mind. He is not a human being. He does not change his mind. So how can he be sorry? Well, if that's not enough, try Malachi 3:6. I am the Lord, and I do not change. And so you, the descendants of Jacob, are not yet completely lost, etc. Well, go back to that 1 Samuel 15 chapter. There's some interesting some other verses that are very interesting in that chapter, because if you look at verses 10 and 11 in that same chapter, it says, the Lord said to Samuel, I am sorry that I made Saul king. This is the same chapter that says, I'm not a human being, I don't change.
And RSV says, the Lord repented that he had made Saul king, which is the same meaning, but just a different way of saying it.
Well, I remember my parents saying, you know, I'm sorry I have to do this, but you're going to have to stay in your room tonight without dinner.
And you didn't think they were sorry at all, right?
Well, I think they were, but...
at the time you thought they were really sorry?
Well... You know,
not near as sorry as you were.
Yeah, I know. It's not that what I thought back then isn't the point. It's the point of what they're saying.
Yeah.
That they're sorry that you have to go to tear room without supper.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So that doesn't mean that they changed their mind, does it?
Well, let's look at the rest of this. So we already said here, Lord was sorry that he said to Samuel, I'm sorry that I made Saul king. Then we go down to verse 29, which we already read. It says, I'm not a human being. I don't change my mind. And we go down to verse 35, same chapter still, same person writing. As long as Samuel lived, he never again saw the king, but he grieved over him. The Lord was sorry he had made Saul king of Israel. I'm sorry I made Saul king. I don't change. I'm sorry I made Saul king.
Could you substitute the word realized in there? He realized that what he knew was coming had arrived. A little bit different.
Yeah. What do we do with that?
I don't have any problem with it.
Oh, you should. What was going on there in the case of Saul? Maybe if we solve that one, since there's the two contrasting things right in one chapter, we can come back and apply here in Genesis. What was going on in the case of Saul?
Mm-hmm.
Who was it that wanted Saul as king?
The people.
Wasn't God's idea. He didn't want to make Saul king. God was sorry he made Saul king before he made him king. He knew this was going to be a disaster. God had, there was nothing wrong with his foreknowledge, but he knew that's what the people wanted, so he said, okay, I will give you the kind of person you want and watch and see what happens. So is God sorry that he had to send the flood? Yeah, he's sorry. He knew it was coming. He knew exactly what was coming. But he had to let it happen because there's a lot of lessons we need to learn from it.
I've heard people preach about that, the verse we read before about God being sorry. Mm-hmm. And it's very problematic because once you say that, you're inferring almost like, you know, you have to throw away the plan of salvation.
Yeah.
And that makes no sense at all.
Yeah. Well, there's a very easy way, as I suggested. God knew in advance all this stuff. He didn't want it to go like this way, but he knew it was going to go like that, and now he has to deal with it. He was sorry from the beginning. So the problem which developed just before the flood seemed to have resulted from the sons of God becoming interested in marrying the daughters of men. Many of our Christian friends believe that angels actually came down and cohabited with human females. Well, the first thing we need to understand is that angels can't produce. They can't reproduce even if they wanted to. Who was it that wanted to reproduce and can't?
Satan.
If there was any possible way for him to reproduce even with a human female, he would have been doing it eons ago. He would have a list of females like you wouldn't believe. It is true that there are other places in the Bible where the expression sons of God may refer to angels. Compare Job 1 and 1 verse 6 and 2 verse 1. The term sons of God is apparently referring to the leaders of other worlds in those verses. But Ellen White said clearly that in this passage, the term sons of God is a reference to the descendants of Seth, and the term daughters of men is a reference to the daughters of the descendants of Cain. And you can read that in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 81, paragraph 2. So we're seeing...
Also in Deuteronomy,
uh-huh.
I think in Deuteronomy 32:8, he says, for he fixed the bounds of his peoples according to the number of the sons of God.
Mm-hmm.
So that's another reference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, what we've seen here is something that unfortunately is repeated again and again and again in the Bible. When you start mixing up evil and good, what happens?
Evil comes out on top.
The evil comes out on top, and almost every time the good collapses. What does that tell us about our day?
Well, we can see it happening in front of us on a daily basis.
As it was in the days of Noah.
Yeah.
I wonder if there's kind of a message there that needs to be.
There better be a message there.
Yeah, but it might be different than you think. It might be...
Speak up.
It might be the fact that we can't produce good.
No.
No matter what we do.
We're not self-existent and we can't produce good on our...
If good is defined by the law, which we're talking about, and the law is God's character, maybe the law is only his character, and that he comes in us somehow, like when Jesus says, I and you in me, and me in him, you know. And that's what actually is supposed to happen. That's what was supposed to happen from the beginning. Mm-hmm.
Well, unfortunately, the people in Noah's day did exactly what they wanted to do. And they didn't want any inhibitions of any kind. I had a patient in my office today, and she had been married to 4 men, and she says, I don't want to have anything more to do with them. I want to do what I want to do, when I want to do it. I want to get up when I want to get up. I want to go to bed when I want to get to bed. And I don't want anyone telling me what to do. And I said, wow, there's a great controversy sitting right in front of me.
Well, isn't that just freedom?
Well, some people would consider that freedom. Yeah.
Well, freedom without very much sacrifice, but it's freedom.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it gets back to the moral choice, though, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Unbeknownst to her, probably.
So we move on. Look at Genesis 6. Let's read verses 9 to 11 now. This is the story of Noah. He had 3 sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Noah had no faults and was the only good man of his time. Is that really true? Noah had no faults? He lived in fellowship with God, but everyone else was evil in God's sight, and violence had spread everywhere. So, are we supposed to believe, really, that Noah was sinless?
No.
Or as he said, was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. That's similar to what he said about Job, isn't it?
Blameless in his generation? In Job, it says he was a perfect and upright man. The King James says perfect and upright.
Right. Uh-huh. Well, yeah. That'd be righteous.
Yeah.
One who does right.
Blameless might not be absolute.
No. Okay, the real question is this. If you had been God in Noah's day, what would you have done?
Well, God had to do something to keep from losing contact with the earth.
If he had just waited another couple of generations, there wouldn't have been anybody listening to God.
Oh. And if it was 120 years, that was quite a long period of time. So God, his foreknowledge knew the end result, so he started earlier there.
So after such a horrendous thing as the flood, everybody straightened up and lived perfectly righteous lives, right?
Not according to Genesis.
No.
What happened after the flood?
Started building cities.
If you excuse me for using Ellen White's words once again, many of them denied the existence of God and attributed the flood to the operation of natural causes. Others believed in a supreme being and that it was he who had destroyed the antediluvian world, and their hearts, like that of Cain, rose up in rebellion against him. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 119. Well, then came Abraham. Look at Genesis 12, 1-3. The Lord said to Abram, leave your country, your relatives, and your family's home, and go to a land that I'm going to show you. I will give you many descendants, and they will become a great nation. I will bless you and make your name famous so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, but I will curse those who curse you, and through you I will bless all the nations. That's a pretty incredible promise. Why is God making such a promise to Abram?
To demonstrate faith. He's going to teach He's going to teach us and him what faith is all about.
Okay, let's talk about that for a moment. Why did Abraham need to get out of his home country? Why not be a missionary right there?
Because where he was going idolatrous, or already was.
And even his own family were already worshiping idols.
If he didn't move him, he was going to lose him. So Abraham must have been a reasonably upright man for starters.
The only question I have for that is, he moved out, but where did he go? He went to a place that just had the same amount of idolatry. He was so scared he had to call his wife his sister, or else he was actually scared for his life. So I don't know if he was escaping anything. I think the point might be there that the Lord is calling him out.
It's one thing to be escape with your life. It's something else very different to end up ignoring God, and you're the only one around that's still listening to God, and suddenly God has no one on planet Earth who's even paying any attention to him. That's a completely different story.
You know, he went west to
to Haran first.
Yeah, but then he ended up over there Melchizedek.
Yeah, and then
and he must have learned something from Melchizedek, wouldn't you think?
That probably they helped each other.
I mean,
Well, we know quite a bit about the life of Abraham. A lot of the book of Genesis is about him, about his wife and how he lied about his wife and so forth.
And clear down to Egypt.
Yeah. Imagine walking from southern Iraq to Egypt. Mm-hmm. Wow.
How long would something like that take?
A long time.
Maybe the land was a bit more fruitful back then.
Yeah, but that doesn't make the walking any quicker.
No, you're right, but it's not, I don't think it was quite the desert it is now, probably.
Yeah. That's probably 800 miles at least, would be my guess. And remember that Abraham lived at a time where there was no church, no pastors, no Bible, no fellowship of any kind that might resemble a church. How did he maintain that relationship with God?
Well, maybe the fact that he was leaving helped him maintain that relationship with God. When you leave your home and you don't know exactly where, what's going to happen the next day, you kind of hold on to God. So there's probably something to that.
That was part of the reason for asking him to move, huh?
No, I'm just saying that that was part of the effect of keeping him close to God.
Do you think Abraham had regular conversations with God?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we know he did later on.
Well, there's events in the Bible that were marked out, but I'm not sure if there were any more than that.
Well, I mean, do you think you would have the faith of an Abraham if you had maybe 5 or 6 visits from God in your entire life?
Well, I haven't had any visits from him, and I'm expected to
have a whole Bible and a whole set of books from Ellen White and so forth. I mean, you better not complain.
Yeah, well, Bible's a Bible.
And a lot of history to look back to.
Okay, but is that going to really give you faith?
It should.
That's what it's meant to do.
Well, I'm not sure.
That's the whole point.
I'm not sure. If it gives everybody faith, then everybody who reads it will have faith.
In context, you'll see that certain things were foretold. You see that there's some fulfillment. Maybe there's some instruction here, and this is a book of instruction. Isn't that what it means, Torah?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting to notice that when Abraham got down to Egypt, Pharaoh seemed to know what was right. And he got back there and he got mixed up with Abimelech. Abimelech had some idea of what was right. Where did they get their ideas of what was right?
The Lord appeared to them and said, "Don't do this."
Well,
I think that would do it. If something came to you and said not to do something, I don't think you would disregard it, no matter who you were.
Adam and Eve were told not to do something, and they did it. So with this, we have the rest of history.
There were certain facets probably were passed on.
Mm-hmm.
And most nations have had a similar code of laws.
In the final test, of course, Abraham proved absolutely trustworthy, and you remember the story of Genesis 22 and the offering of Isaac. Many scholars believe that the Ten Commandments, as well as many of the other laws that Moses wrote down, were really copied from Egyptian and Mesopotamian codes from earlier days. What do we know about those earlier codes?
Well, the Egyptians, for one, had idols, and probably lots of others did.
Mm-hmm.
Abraham knew there was one God.
Yeah.
Those ancient stories they had, the gods were warring with each other, and their law codes, they'd have death penalties for even minor infractions. Mm-hmm. So you put that in the context of what with the Bible, and God says, when he says eye for an eye, tooth for tooth, that was a progression,
yes.
a seeming relaxation of arbitrary, vengeful rules. Not that God even wants that, but at least he can move them some distance away
from
those.
Way down, even in the days of Jesus, one slave got upset and killed one of the Roman senators, mm-hmm. and they slaughtered 400 slaves as a payment, so that no slave would get the idea of ever doing that again.
Well, they also had a lot of sacrificings to mm-hmm. appease the wrath of the offended deities.
Mm-hmm.
And
we know Moses learned a lot in the desert. I see no reason why Abram couldn't have either.
Mm-hmm. Well, we know that God teaches that there's only one God. These other religions have laws about the gods, this God and that God and all this kind of stuff. And even though there are some similarities, my explanation, I think, is a very simple one. I think that God gave those laws to Adam way back in the beginning, and they passed down. And even these people from pagan origins, they have at least some idea left of what's right and what's wrong.
God didn't abandon them.
No. So in the book of Deuteronomy, we get the message that God will bless us if we do what is right, and he will curse us if we do what is wrong. And several places in the book of Deuteronomy, there are the blessings and the curses. What is that supposed to teach us? Isn't that what the Pharisees believe in Jesus' day? You know, if you do what's right, God will bless you and you'll be rich. So if you drive a Mercedes, that's proof that you're a good person, that kind of stuff. They absolutely, that was the gospel to them. Well, why do you think God chose the descendants of Abraham to be his special chosen people?
Because they promised him. He would.
Well, God picked them out. They didn't pick him.
They picked him out?
Yes.
They picked them out.
God picked them out. They didn't pick him out.
They weren't even born yet.
Well, but I mean, if you go back to the early history.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, look at what God says. Now we're coming down to the formation of the children of Israel, and we're looking at Exodus 19, verses 5 and 6. Now, if you will obey me and keep my covenant, you will be my own people. The whole earth is mine, but you will be my chosen people, a people dedicated to me alone, and you will serve me as priests. What is that supposed to mean?
Representatives of him. That's what he was implying, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Well, that was tied into the descendants were supposed to be a holy people.
Mm-hmm. And represent God.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were supposed to represent God in everything they did.
So what was the importance of descendants?
Well, of course, in ancient days, they believed that characteristics and rights and privileges were handed down from father to son to son to son. That was the idea.
In ancient days?
Oh, yeah.
So God would happen to use an illustration of a culture that may not last till today to make his point?
I
guess what I'm saying is that are you sure it's because of that? Or was there a reason that God was sticking to
the
descendants, so to speak.
I will take you to the New Testament. Look at 1 Peter 2, verse 9, and where he says, "Now to the Christian church, but you are a chosen nation, the king's priest, the holy nation, God's own people, chosen to proclaim the wonderful acts of God who called you out of darkness into his own marvelous light." I mean, that's virtually verbatim to the words he said about the children of Israel, isn't it? So what's happened here? God had chosen a group of people to be his representatives on earth. Mm-hmm. They finally failed to do their job. So what does God do? He starts out with a group of disciples. And he said, whoever you can bring in, those who are faithful and true, now you're going to become my representatives here on planet Earth. Right?
Yeah.
Well, look at Galatians 3. There's some very interesting words there in Galatians 3. I'm going to start with verse 6. Consider the experience of Abraham. As the scripture says, he believed God, and because of his faith, God accepted him as righteous. You should realize then that the real descendants of Abraham are the people who have faith. Now, Paul is playing a little bit fast and loose with, that's not fair to say. Paul is here saying, I want you to recognize what was really important about Abraham. The scripture predicted that God will put the Gentiles right with himself through faith. And where did he get that idea? Back there in Genesis 12, what did it say? Through you, right here. So the scripture announced the good news to Abraham. Through you, God will bless the whole human race. There it is, right in Genesis 12, right? Abraham believed and was blessed. So all who believe are blessed as he was. And in the days of the apostles, what was the symbol that meant that you were a faithful Jew, a really faithful Jew?
Circumcision.
Was Abraham circumcised when the promise was made to him? No. And Paul points that out very strongly. See, he says what matters is your relationship to God and not whether you're circumcised. And, of course, he goes on, now it is clear that no one is put right with God by means of the law, because the scripture says only the person who is put right with God through faith shall live. But the law has nothing to do with faith. Instead, as the scripture says, whoever does everything the law requires will live. And, of course, all of us have done everything that the law requires, right?
Well, the thing about Christ's time, they were so bound up in right and wrong, they'd basically lost the face of God.
Yeah.
A totally different thing, and they'd lost it again.
Well, he goes on, Christ did, and anyone who's hanged under a tree is under God's curse. Last part of verse 13. Christ did this in order that the blessing which God promised to Abraham might be given to the Gentiles by means of Christ Jesus, so that through faith we might receive the Spirit promised by God. What do you suppose that means? Isn't that talking about God passing from dealing with the Jews strictly as a nation, as his special representatives? He's passing over to the time when the Christian church becomes his representative? Then he talks about how we can be slaves, etc., and made his promises to God and his descendants. And then he talks about descendant, and he says the promise really was to Jesus Christ himself. And then we come down to verse 19. What then was the purpose of the law? Now that's what our whole series of lessons is about, right? It was added in order to show what wrongdoing is. And it was meant to last until the coming of Abraham's descendant, to whom the promise was made. So, and you go on, it's pretty involved there. We won't take time. I'd love to take time to discuss the rest of Galatians 3. Abraham and Sarah certainly had to learn patience. Do we need to learn patience as well? Yeah. And why do I say they had to learn patience?
Waiting for a baby.
Waiting for a baby. Did they wait a long time or what?
Yeah. Is that teaching us something about faith too?
Yeah.
How it needs to hold on?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Endurance, patience, faith. Mm-hmm. Well, What was the church supposed to learn from the life and death of Jesus? It would turn the whole world upside down? Because that's what the world said, remember? Even their enemies said, these people have come out here and they've turned the whole world upside down. Are we doing that today? Turning the world upside down?
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
We should.
What's the problem?
Well, what would be the definition? What would you see if the world was being turned upside down?
You would see things changing. Very,
changing to
very
what?
Big change. Well, if we're to take the gospel, I mean, the New Testament experience as an example, things would be changing for the better.
Things would be changing for the better.
A lot of more people would be living and acting and claiming to be Christians.
I think persecution was changed into.
Yeah. Well, eventually in the early 16th century, the Protestant Reformation occurred. And Christianity came alive again. People really stood up for what they believed in. But unfortunately, the followers of Luther and Calvin and others of the Reformers seem to have had a very difficult time going beyond those initial steps. They sort of feel like, oh, if we just go back and capture Luther, we can just go back and capture Calvin, we don't need to go anywhere beyond them, right? Well, eventually, as we know, through the great religious awakening of the early 19th century, a group of people formed who would focus on the second coming of Jesus Christ. And what does the Bible say about that group? Well, here's a couple of verses. Look at Revelation 12, 17. The dragon was... Who's the dragon?
Satan.
The dragon was furious with the woman and went off to fight against the rest of her descendants, all those who obey God's commandments and are faithful to the truth revealed by Jesus. And so what do they do? What do these faithful people do? I just read it to you. They keep the commandments and they're faithful to the truth revealed by Jesus or through Jesus or in Jesus. Well, look at Revelation 14:12. This calls for endurance on the part of God's people, those who obey God's commandments and are faithful to Jesus. Okay? So where does the law come in and all that? What does it mean when it says we keep the commandments?
We obey the law.
We obey the law, yeah.
So obeying the law is the mark of God's people.
Doesn't it seem like that's what it's saying?
That means they're keeping the law perfectly.
Well, I mean, you have to be careful now. How far are you going to take that?
Well, you're leaving it open.
Yeah, well, but I'm...
When you say we keep the law and we respect Jesus, I mean, how far... What are we seeing when that happens?
I'm saying that we've been studying this whole series of lessons about Christ and the law. Mm-hmm. Now we're coming down to crunch time. We're coming down to our day. We're coming down to the end of this world's history. Mm-hmm. And what's going to happen? There's going to be a group. It may not be a huge group. It's just a remnant. But there's going to be a group of people who are going to start taking God's word seriously. They're going to start keeping the commandments. They're going to correctly and faithfully represent God. They're going to say the same things. Say the same things about God that Jesus did. They're going to bear the testimony of Jesus, say what he did. And God is going to say, here's my people. These are the ones I've been waiting for. Let's wind it up. There's no reason to wait any longer.
Or you could say that the Spirit of God is going to enter them to do all those things.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Why not?
Well, then what's being held back? Is it God doing that, or is it people keeping the commandments? Do you have to keep the commandments first before the Spirit will come?
If you're talking about faithfully keeping the commandments, I'm reminded of a motto I saw just recently. See if I can quote it correctly. It says, God loves you. Don't wait until you are like you should be before you come to God, because none of us are like we should be.
Okay, well, right now, everybody's not like they should be, right?
Exactly.
So the Lord could come, I mean, the Spirit could come any time, even though we're not like we should be.
Yeah.
So.
And why do you,
why do you think
God's Spirit hasn't come until now?
Because he's chosen not to. Because if you ask that, well, then you're saying, well, he's waiting for us to do something, which could be nothing but to keep the commandments correctly.
I didn't say that.
What are you saying?
I'm looking at 2 Peter 3:10 to 12, and I'm saying God is waiting for us because he does not, you know, the Holy Spirit does four things for us. Let's just review them very quickly. He gives us life. He sustains our lives every day. Okay. He woos us. He tries to attract us to God's side in the Great Controversy. Then, if we are attracted to God's side in the Great Controversy, he actually convicts us and leads to baptism. Says, you need to have a conviction. You need to join the church. You need to do what's right. And if all those things work out, then he gifts us. That is, there are gifts of the Spirit, and those gifts are given for one purpose and one purpose only, and that's to correctly represent God to the world. That's what we're supposed to be doing.
That's his gift.
Those are the gifts of the Spirit.
That's like the Spirit coming to fulfill that.
Yes.
I've been in the church.
Yeah.
I'm even here studying the Bible. That means it must be important to me.
Yes.
Okay, so how come things are still the same?
Well, because I think, and again, you know, I don't think that a few of us here are going to suddenly start the latter rain, but I think the time is coming when there's going to be a separation between those who represent God correctly, who really want to obey God's commandments, they really want to represent Jesus correctly, and those who don't.
Yeah, I agree with that.
We haven't had the fire. Mm-hmm. Or the absolute conviction of the first apostles.
Yeah. Well, it's so easy to become legalistic about keeping the commandments. We need to remember that the best commandment keepers, and I'm using this with quotation marks around it, the best commandment keepers of all time are the ones who crucified Jesus and then wished he would die as quick as possible so they could quickly stuff him in a grave so they could rush home in time to keep the Sabbath holy.
Yeah.
What does that tell us? Pretty scary, huh?
Yes.
Well, we now stand near the end of this earth's history. If we're to believe Revelation 14, 6 to 12, and what's found in Revelation 14, 6 to 12?
Three angels' messages.
The three angels' messages.
Yes.
What is the relationship between the three angels' messages and the Seventh-day Adventist Church?
Well,
pretty important.
His love of God and give him the glory. That was the first one.
Worship the Creator.
The next one is Babylon was fallen.
Mm-hmm.
And the final one was, if you've got the mark in the forehead of your hand, mm-hmm. you're going to drink the wine of the wrath of God.
Okay. And who has claimed to carry that message?
Christianity.
Haven't we claimed that we are the bearers of these three angels' messages?
Yeah.
I can remember as a child, when someone joined the Adventist Church, we used to say, he has accepted the third angel's message. Some of you might have been around long enough to remember them saying that. He has accepted the third angel's message. Ellen White talked about that. Well, look at these words from Ellen White, since we're talking about her. This is from Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 455, going on to 456. The three angels of Revelation 14 represent the people who accept the light of God's messages and go forth as his agents to sound the warning throughout the length and breadth of the earth. What are they doing?
They're being missionaries.
They're being missionaries. They have accepted God's message. They're correctly representing God, right? Okay. Christ declares to his followers, ye are the light of the world, Matthew 5:14. To every soul that accepts Jesus, the cross of Calvary speaks, behold the worth of the soul, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, Mark 16:15. Nothing is to be permitted to hinder this work. It is the all-important work for this time. It is to be far-reaching as eternity. The love that Jesus manifested for the souls of men and their sacrifice which he made for their redemption will actuate all his followers. So that's 5T, 455 and 456. Do you find, as you look around in your church and you out there in your church, do you find that the thing which activates your fellow church members or you as well, are you activated by wanting to get this message out to the world? Is that the most important thing in your whole life? Well, let's try another one. This is Evangelism, page 196. The theme of greatest importance is the third angel's message, embracing the messages of the first and second angels. All should understand the truths contained in these messages and demonstrate them in daily life, for this is essential to salvation. Now, are we demonstrating the truths of the three angels' messages in our daily lives? This is essential to salvation. We shall have to study earnestly, prayerfully, in order to understand these grand truths, and our power to learn and comprehend will be taxed to the utmost. Evangelism, page 196.
Does that happen because of understanding?
Yes, at least partly.
Partly?
The Holy Spirit will never gift us, never bless us, never pour out the latter rain on us to go out and misrepresent God.
Yeah.
So?
You're supposed to study it and exhibit it.
Why did God use that very strong language that we read in the third angel's message?
It's important that we get it right.
Important. Yeah, we're talking about life and eternal life and death, aren't we?
Right. Yes.
Are these an arbitrary statement from God? He's just trying to prove who's boss?
No.
Why does God give the three angels' message? The third angels. Let's look at specifically the third. Why do you think God gave that message?
Convey a sense of urgency.
Look back in the previous chapter. What did Satan say? No one could buy or sell without having his mark, or this mark, that is the beast's name or the number that stands for the name. Satan says, if you don't join my side, you're going to die. Isn't that what he's saying? Yeah, if you don't join my side, you're going to die. And what does God say? If you don't join my side, you're going to miss eternal life. Isn't that what he's saying?
Yep.
Yeah. So this is not God just sort of arbitrarily saying, well, I'm going to prove who's boss here. He's responding to a threat from Satan's side. Let's go back to Abraham. Do we have the faith of Abraham? Well, what is faith? There's a Greek word. The Greek word is pistis in the New Testament. And it's translated with four different words in English. Faith, trust, confidence, or belief. One of the best definitions of faith that I have ever read, and one I love because it was written by a friend of mine, Dr. A. Graham Maxwell. And he wrote it like this. Faith is just a word we use to describe a relationship with God as with a person well known. The better we know him, the better the relationship may be. We can't say will be because who knew God best of all? Lucifer, right? And he still rebelled. Faith, going on, implies an attitude toward God of love, trust, and deepest admiration. It means having enough confidence in God, based on the more than adequate evidence revealed, to be willing to believe what he says as soon as we're sure he's the one saying it. We have to be careful here. Remember, we believe someone is going to come, someone is coming, who's going to claim to be God and say all sorts of lies about God. Okay? Then we need to accept, going back to our definition, we need to accept what he offers as soon as we're sure he's the one who's offering it, and to do what he wishes as soon as we are sure he's the one wishing it, without reservation, for the rest of eternity. Anyone who has such faith would be perfectly safe to save. This is why faith is the only requirement for salvation, for heaven. Faith also means that, like Abraham and Moses, God's friends, we know God well enough to reverently ask him why. And Dr. Maxwell used to quote that quite frequently. And if you would like a copy of that, feel free to go to our website, Theox, that's theox.org, and download the handout for this week's lesson. Theologians and educated Christians love to talk about justification by faith and sanctification by faith and righteousness by faith and even salvation by faith. And what's the common thread in all those?
Faith.
Okay? Why is faith so important? Why did Paul say, remember Acts 16, let's look at that, Acts 16, verse 31. They answered, this is Paul and Silas speaking to the jailer there in Philippi, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your family. And that's the word pistis there. Have faith in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Doesn't say, sign your name on the dotted line for I believe the 28 beliefs. It doesn't say do the 28 voice of prophecy lessons. It says have faith. Why is faith so important? It's that relationship between us and God. Without a relationship with God, we don't have anything. So by our words and by our lives, we are proclaiming the three angels' messages. Are we? Are we demonstrating the kind of love that Jesus kept talking about? Well, our adult teacher's Bible study guide gave us these words. Seventh-day Adventists almost seem to be ashamed of our distinctive truths. Some see the application of the term remnant to the Seventh-day Adventist Church as an exclusivist idea. In this lesson, we want to emphasize that the term remnant, while being biblically based, carries with it not a sense of superiority, but a validation for mission. We are privileged to be part of the thread of God's salvation story that began in Eden and will conclude with Jesus' second coming. Seventh-day Adventists have been chosen to proclaim the final message to the world. Think of all the times when it seemed like God's faithful people were almost wiped out at the flood, in Elijah's day, even at the first coming of Jesus. And so we come down here. Revelation 14:4 talks about following the Lamb wherever he leads. Where did lambs end up at in the Old Testament?
Slaughter.
They were slaughtered. Where did Jesus end up at?
He was slaughtered.
Are we prepared to follow him wherever he goes? Go back and read Revelation 14 again. Revelation 14, verse 4. Are you prepared to follow Jesus wherever he goes? Think about it. Something to talk about over lunch.